So everyone, I'll introduce our moderator of the session. Bharat Khatri, country lead, Xaxis India. Bharat has over a decade experience across digital and sales domains. Bharat has spent the last 5 years working relentlessly to grow Xaxis in India. He started his journey with Xaxis as a client engagement manager. Everybody, we have a moderator here on the stage. Give it up for Bharat Khatri, ladies and gentlemen. Allow me to introduce our panelists now. I begin by inviting the founder and CEO of the 120 Media Collective, Roopak Saluja, everyone. Listed among the 2014 campaign Asia Pacific 40 under 40, Roopak is founder and chief executive officer of the 120 Media Collective, a communications and content group working with some of Asia's largest advertisers through its subsidiaries. Can we all make some noise for Roopak, everyone? Come on. Come back to the day, please. Come back to the evening. Go ahead, grab your coffee, join us back. And our next panelist for this session is Varun Duggirala, ladies and gentlemen, content chief and co-founder The Glitch, TEDx speaker, entrepreneur by day, writer by night, full-time content chief with a background in broadcast production at MTV and Channel V. Varun co-founded The Glitch with Rohit in year 2009. And today, The Glitch is one of the largest creative digital agencies in the country and was recently acquired by global advertising giant WPP and will operate as an independent brand under the group M. Everyone, can we all make some noise for Varun on the panel? Our next panelist is the Chief Branding and Marketing Officer of FabIndia, Karan Kumar, everyone. Karan is a brand and marketing strategist who uses intelligent storytelling to successfully drive brand conversions by developing messages that persuade and captivate. Joining us on the panel today, we have Karan Kumar. Thank you, Karan, for joining us, everyone. Let's welcome Karan. And also joining us today, we have Aarti, Bhardwaj, everyone. Let's welcome her, the Vice President, Client Analytics, APAC Ascends. As the Client Analytics Lead in APAC, she creates learning agendas based on actionable, measurable objectives and actively designs and executes new ways to measure and optimize client campaigns. So here is our panel for you, and I request the moderator to take it over from here.
Cool. Thanks. Thanks for the warm intro. I think the way we wanted to talk about today is a little bit about what we do off the work, but it's good to get an introduction about a professional background. So just a little bit about what I do off the work. I'm a big foodie. Coming into this profession was actually converting my passion to a profession. Started blogging in during my college days and identify how I can monetize my blog through a tool called AdSense. Rest is the journey for the last one decade. Over to Roopak.
Thank you. I think you already did a bit of an intro over there, so I'll just focus a little bit on my company. We've been around for about 12 years. The 120 Media Collective is a communications and content group, which has three main constituent parts. Jack in the Box lies at the center of it, which is a content and creative-led digital-first communications agency. We've got Bang Bang, India's international production company, which is one of the largest TV commercials production companies. And then we have Superfly, which is which creates digital video content for brands en masse in a planned manner. And so for us, we're very focused on creating measurable business impact through content for brands.
I think she covered pretty much everything that I do. But as Glitch, what is unique about us is the fact that there is Glitch, which is the mother brand in terms of the creative agency that we are. We handle everything from digital to mainline to 360 in that sense. Whereas we also produce our entire content as well. So we have a unit called Flux, which does a lot of content. So we have a weird mix of content production meets creative agency, yet in some ways also focusing on e-com and sales as well. So we bring an interesting blend to that piece.
I just do simple things. I just try and figure out the smart people to work with. And once I find them out, I start working with them. So it's quite simple, actually. So I think for any marketer, the starting point always is the consumer. I guess for everybody on this panel, and we all marketers in our own right, the starting part a point is the consumer. So understanding what works for her, what doesn't work for her, combining various data sources, getting into some patterns, getting into some this lovely word called insights that everybody use. And then using that to create pieces of stories, content, audiovisual, non-audiovisual, to try and figure out how one can pitch the larger brand idea to that consumer base. Quite simple, actually, right? There's nothing too complicated. And if you can, in that process, try and find good people to work with, life's pretty easy. So I live a very simple life.
So a little bit about the company. I work with Essence, which is part of Group M and a data and measurement-centric company. Our purpose is to make advertising more valuable to the world. And we look at value in two ways. Value, of course, to marketers to be able to build brands, to be able to deliver business. But also value to consumers in terms of making every interaction with them count. So every interaction that a brand makes with consumers should count for something. They should take away some experience. I'm a completely left-brained math person, but I try and make that math come alive for, in terms of that beautiful word, insights. Because at the end of the day, any of the data and analytics that we use has to talk about humans. Marketing is all about talking with humans, and it cannot be reduced to an engineering problem. There is a certain creativity even in the way we take up the challenges in data.
Cool. Thanks, Aarti. Thanks, Karan. Thanks, Varun. And thanks, Roopak. I think the way we wanted to start is, let me pick up one keyword which Karan just talked about, insights, because that's something very close to my heart, and that's on which my business also exists. So I work for a company called Xaxis, which is the programmatic arm for WPP and Group M. And for us, insights is all about identifying what an user is doing on a digital world versus an offline world, and how we can repackage these insights and go back to marketeers like Karan, Aarti, Varun, and Roopak to make them understand where they should invest and what type of content they need to make. So coming from the programmatic, coming from the technology world, for us, data and insights always revolve around a user-generated content, a cookie or an ad ID. But I wanted to understand what insights and data is for you, actually. Do you see data from the same lens how we guys see, which is more of a operational lens of execution of an activity, a campaign, bringing a meaningful insights out for you as a brand to understand whether this data point will bring some outcome, or is it something other way around?
So I think, Bharat, no one can see data the way you guys see it. You guys are Xaxis, and you have access to every WPP touchpoint that exists. Okay, so, however, I think to me, insights is all good, and with the development of technology, with AI and every other buzzword that you can think of, the level to which the data and insights that you get more and more refined is increasing at a rapid pace. I think what's much more important, though, for me personally, is to focus on the actions that result from those insights, right? What are you actually doing? And, you know, there could be two types of actions that you take. There's obviously actions that go into iterating and improving and making the content that you're already creating more and more effective. And the other type of action, actually, which to me is the holy grail, is actually using that across your marketing mix and across your touch points to further induce whatever it might be that you're after, whether it is moving an audience cluster from awareness to interest and consideration, or even to purchase and loyalty, depending on your product category. So I think that really the focus should be on what kind of actions you're taking. And for that, it's really not really about the technology at all. It's really about an approach. It's about a philosophy to how you approach the entire mix.
You know, you spoke about food, right, initially. Every piece of food you eat has a different recipe. Every piece of content, the insights are a part of that recipe, but it depends on what that food requires. In some cases, you need to go hardcore into the insights, really dig into that and really use it to create the kind of content you need to. In some cases, that's almost validation, and in many cases, just that added piece you need there to make sure that the overall thing makes sense. So from a content lens per se, it's totally about where that really fits into the mix.
You want all four of us to answer that, is it?
Any insightful video thought which you can bring in?
The first thing that I want to say, and I'm sure it's a very intelligent audience here, there is no one thing called data. It's not a monolith. It's a very heterogeneous animal, right? So this entire thing of do I work with data or not, data is not one gorilla, right? Data needs to be cut and used depending on what your specific requirements are. So there is data that can happen from the information that I collect from my visitor books in my store. There is data that I get from social listening. There is data that I get from surveys that I administer. There is data that I get from my agency partners who are doing a check on campaign performance. And therefore, there are multiple kinds of data, right? And that's the reason I say that data is not one monolithic animal. So long as you're clear about what you want data to do, and what is that data helping you from a decision-making point of view, I think you're in the clear. It's when you start using data as a shortcut to certain other decision-making processes, which is where the problem happens, right? And I'm sure there are enough and more intelligent marketers around the fraternity who know that difference. But for those of us who don't understand that difference, I think we do a great amount of disservice to data without understanding it and its usage, but still claiming that we work with data. So that's point one. The second point is, the other thing that I want to clarify is that, and I see this being used very interchangeably and almost too casually for my comfort, data does not equal to insights. Data is different and insights is different, right? Data is an input variable into the process of insight creation. Yeah. You look at data, you start identifying patterns, you start creating hypotheses, you start testing those hypotheses, you arrive at an insight, right? So long as all of us don't casually keep interchangeably, you know, use this word of data and insights, I'm very happy. When they do, I get very concerned.
Thanks, Karan, for bringing the difference between what actually is all about data and what is all about insights. I think on the panel, we have a female analyst, and it will not be fair to me if I don't dig deep and ask Aarti about what actually Essence is all about doing on analytics piece, and whether it's data-driven insights for them or it's other way around.
It's a tough job to be at the end of the panel, because I've got to do now build on something that everybody else has said. But to me, data is a great asset. It's very often called the new oil. But data is a decision support system. It is a means to an end. And at every point, we need to remember that data is messy. Data is, as you mentioned, it's a growing beast, right? And if at every given point of time, we need to go into any analysis, any decision with a very clear hypothesis that we're trying to prove or disprove, right? And when we go in it, go into looking for a ratification or a disproving of a hypothesis to be able to make a decision, we go through the entire journey, as you mentioned, of reporting, generating an insight, and then being able to inform a better decision. And to a certain extent, anything that we do in data or analysis is that feedback loop. So it's the other aspect that I want to spend some time on is also that anything regarding data and analysis is not a, it's a journey. It's not a one project. It's not something that you do at one point of time. At every given point with data or analysis, there's an entire learning curve. There's a loop that happens. Because we collect data to check whether we want to make a certain decision in a certain way, we go out and test certain hypotheses. We find some insights. But it also tells us what more data we need or how else we want to see data. So at any point, it's a constant learning loop And data always fuels that feedback loop that we see. So it's a constant growing cycle.
You know what you said about constantly learning, right? Even if you're making creative, when we were talking about this, I think before we kind of came in, the fact that when you are digging into data to create, let's say, something focused on clear sales in terms of assets, you should be ready to be able to create enough iterative pieces so that, and you keep fine-tuning it to make sure you're hitting the right mark. What's really getting some, what's getting the most reactions, what's pushing someone to really hit that, you know, checkout button, and really keep building that up. And that's really where smart, creative, and data comes together. It shouldn't always be, okay, it's done now, let's analyze it and not do anything about it. And that happens many times.
Yeah. And also, to a certain extent, data can tell you what to do and what not to do. It's always about, like you said, there's the operational aspect of it, right? So when we're trying to get better performance, better click-through rates, better cost per clicks, there's a certain way in which the historical perspective that data gives us helps us fine-tune that some more. But if we analyzed every bit of content that's been put out there, the data will tell you the average amount of content engagement that has been there. But as humans, as consumers, we don't want to see more of the average. We want to see something that's the outlier. And so data pretty much tells you what not to do. It tells you this is the average and don't go there, right? So in that sense, it's more about what are we trying to use the data to do? It's the toolkit. It's as powerful as the hands that use it and the design that it's being used against.
I think, Aarti, what you're pointing out is a very, very important problem to take cognizance of. It's the basic problem with predictive analytics, right? And it's also, if you look at the Facebook echo chamber that's been talked about a lot, it's the same thing. So actually, you're right. It's not just about telling you the normal. It's also about pointing out what the normal is so that you can do something that's different. And I think, just to paraphrase what you were saying earlier, what's very important is to have the systems, the processes, the infrastructure to actually take advantage of the insights. Otherwise, it's of no use, right? And that takes a lot of work. My benchmark for that today, I know Red Bull is obviously stuff that everybody talks about, but my benchmark for that is actually Marriott and how they do it beautifully. You know, they've got this listening command center, I think it's called MLive. They've got their content creation. They have a portal called Marriott Traveler, and they also have an in-house agency. And the way they bring all of this together to actually capitalize on those insights is absolutely phenomenal. You know, whether it's, for example, there's a couple staying at the Ritz-Carlton, which is like their premium brand, and someone says, oh, I just got engaged, and suddenly 15 minutes later, there's a bottle of champagne at their door. That's sort of a very basic way to do it. And then they had, and I was just sort of, you know, thinking about what I was going to speak about today, so I just did a bit of a search, so I'll tell you that quite honestly, which is that I read about this thing where there's a dad, a traveling business traveler, who took pictures of carpets at various hotels, okay? And he would put them up on his Insta feed as Carpet Dad. And it turned out, so MLive picked this up and they found that this guy was actually staying primarily at Marriott properties, and he was a Marriott Platinum double whatever, right? So top tier loyalty guy. They invited this guy and his family to their headquarters outside of Washington, D.C. to design a carpet for their hotel in Texas. And obviously content was created all around it, and it did wonders for engagement and also positive impressions for the brand. So, I mean, if you can actually bring all of that together perfectly, which takes a lot of work, that's when you really see the magic. And to quote Piyush Pandey, you know, you don't need logic, isme magic ki zarurat hai.
I think from the Red Bull point, I can clearly link back one thought which always come into my mind, that as a marketer, how we can make it a welcome message rather than intrusion when I'm watching a content. So I can clearly imagine the way I engage with Red Bull because I'm watching an adventure content. So that ad never looks like an intrusion to my content. It's always a welcome message for me. So I wanted to understand more from maybe Varun, what's the inside story? How the content creation happens on the back end? And are the marketeers really supporting you, giving you that time space to form these content by doing the social listening and the way the markets are changing right now?
So I'm a weird animal, right? I'm part marketer, part creator. So I'm the wrong person to ask this question to, because I have vested interests on both sides. But primarily, how we see it as it's source material, right? Traditionally, writers or content creators would go out into the world to try and find insights to which they would write something. You now have that available to you in a different form, and that's still available. One of my favorite examples from last year is what our guys did on Netflix, right? It was a simple fact that they saw the insight that people were talking about, the fact that why is Radhika obtained every single Netflix show. They took that insight, made it into the film that eventually came out, and that's source material, right? And as long as you look at it in that sense, that it is something that is useful to you, it can be a great tool for any creator. Where it can go totally wrong is the fact that you're trying to sell something which you are unsure of yourself, and you want to make it validation for, you know, to be able to sell it. That's really the wrong way to do it. I mean, that's totally the balance of how I see it. I think Karan will have more insight on.
No, I think content, any piece of content that gets created, I think needs to tick off the contextuality box at two levels. One, of course, it needs to be contextual to the conversation that's happening. So a socially relevant conversation, socially ongoing conversation, it needs to live off it, and it needs to feed it as well. So I think that is one level where you need to tick that box, as it were. But to specifically what you said, watching sport, some pieces of content look intrusive and the other pieces of content don't look intrusive, is that assuming you've done the first, then you come down to what your strategy on publishing that piece of content is. And the publishing part of your content strategy is something that will ensure whether your content comes across as it being intrusive or not. Because you're in a certain headspace at a certain point of time when you're consuming a certain environment, a certain amount of media, right? And what you want to do is ideally have nothing to distract you from the appointment that you've made for consuming the media that you're consuming. Now, if anybody would want to intrude in that space, the least that person needs to be doing is to be not showing you stuff which is contextually relevant at that point of time. So I think that is more a publishing-led, intelligent marketing strategy, which obviously is the second box that you need to tick. But the first box, of course, is when you get to content creation. And I'm sure good content is not about branded advertising as brands used to look at, you know, a couple of years ago. Good content today is something which works for your brand at an essence, at a purpose, at a source level, but most importantly, plugs into conversations that are current, contextual, and ongoing.
So, Aarti, do you think the lens what Karan mentioned about taking these facts out, and then Varun mentioned about going into content creation, from an analytics lens, how you see through it as a pre-journey or a post-journey?
There's both, right? From the perspective of when we're trying to inform what is good content, and as you mentioned, content needs to ride a certain current context. It needs to ride on a certain wave that's underlying within consumers. The way data is able to, and analytics is able to very well inform this, is today we no longer have to restrict ourselves to small groups. We don't any longer have that people like us bias. Otherwise, we'd end up talking to people like us, and we'd end up just ratifying some of our biases. So one of the things that data helps us do is get out of that people like me bias and actually look at what our conversations, and it's sometimes eye-opening how different we are, right? And so data is able to inform in that sense what those true waves are. Having said that, once the content is made, it's no longer a game of we've made the content, now spray it and pray. Data and analytics has also helped read the kind of responsiveness to content. So today we're able to put out 10 creatives, very quickly read what people are engaging with and what people aren't. And we're able to optimize in a way that it delivers more value to brands and businesses. So it's, and then once we've done that, we're also able to look at deconstruct the content that worked and inform brands back as to what kind of content, what elements of their content actually made the connect with clients. So it's a little bit of a deconstruction that's a little bit too rational maybe, but it does help better decision making in terms of what content to create.
You know, one of my favorite things to say is the fact that you can't go full digital with data anymore. It's digital plus analog. Like most times we look at validation in terms of insights from something we've actually done from the data. But what we also turn around to sometimes is test multiple samples with actual consumers. I don't think that really goes away, right? Today you might not get the person into the room. We might do it by VC, but it's still important to test three kinds of creative and see what they react to the most. Nothing's richer than that data, right? That's still data, and I think that's a core part we should always keep around.
I think the one thing which probably I can link back is the more, the deeper, the digger we go, it's always bring out the hunger for personalization. Especially in a case of digital video marketing space, more and more brands going into more personalized communication. One single creative which probably you're airing on a linear TV becomes 1,000 content variables using machine learning, AI, and predictive. So do you guys think that machine and the predictive analogy is ever able to link back the emotional factor, what goes into the content creation space?
My one-word answer would be no. Marketing is about talking to human beings. Analytics is about quantifiable and observable metrics. Human beings in their very nature are chaotic and unpredictable. And no amount of predictive analytics can ever, ever predict accurately human behavior. And that's just the reality of it. So, which is why analytics is not engineering. It's a little bit of a creative craft. So no, the machines aren't coming. They're not taking over our lives.
One hard fact, which I was reading through while coming back here. By 2020, India as a market is expecting that 95% of the content which is getting hosted on the platforms might not be watched by humans. So you need someone to vet these contents, and a human can't vet all these content before it go to air. So do you guys still think that the bot will play a role of vetting a content before it goes air?
Well, I don't know about vetting content before it goes on. I don't think that'll be the case. I don't know how effective that would be. But what I can tell you, if it's used in the right way, and I think I have a slightly different take from what Aarti said, because at the end of the day, storytelling is about resonating, the audience resonating with the characters, the storyline, or in this case, the brand. As long as you're using that to better inform the content that you're producing, it'll be effective. Just to give you an idea of what's going on at Netflix, and this is not on the brand side, but my brother is an AI scientist who works with Netflix in Los Angeles, and he and his team have been hired to work on AI that will scour the world for potential sources of content based on all the analytics they have on what kind of content does well. So books, TV plays, newspaper articles, real life incidents, this AI will capture it all and funnel it into the development pipeline. Just imagine that.
Yes, we will always capture data. We will always capture more data, and yet there will always be that outlier. There will always be that one unpredictable scenario. Because let's remember that data and analytics has a historical bias to it. We can predict things that have happened in the past, but any analytics construct cannot simulate or predict something that's never happened in the past. And that's one thing that as marketers, as content creators, that's one caveat we always have to remember. And that's the only reason that I say that, we can't predict everything. We just can't. Data and analytics can get very close to and can be right 90% of the time, but we have to know that there is going to be that 10% that is unpredictable, and that's just humans.
Yeah, so data and analytics will give you certain certain go and no-go areas, right? Today, for example, with a certain degree of certainty at what rate video content performs better than non-video content. Right? you know what is the kind of duration and average second age video content works better than the other piece of second age. You also know that there are certain platforms which do better on one kind of content versus another. So Twitter does something very good which Instagram does not, and Instagram does something very good which perhaps Facebook does not. So all of this for me is data. All of this for me is understanding, right? The thing is, and I think where she's also coming from, is that once you have all these data pieces in place, or data sources, or data insights in place, I think the creation of the final strategy and the creation of the final creative is still something which requires human ingenuity. Yes. And that human ingenuity will not get replaced by AI and ML. AI and ML will give you certain inputs into decision making, but which inputs to take and which inputs to ignore, which inputs to take with what degree of weightage and otherwise, how do you combine some of those inputs and ignore some others, and thereafter create a certain piece of content that works, I think that will still be left to human ingenuity. Good question. If bots will at some point of time consume data, and it's actually a much more serious and a larger question. 10 years from now, if an Alexa or Alexa's equivalent is going to order things on your behalf, then what kind of a marketing campaign do you need to run, not for Alexa's owner to decide what he needs, but for Alexa to instinctively respond to you? It's a different, and it's a very serious question, actually, maybe for another time in another debate. But that time is not too far, because you will have machine systems that will go on to do a lot of purchasing and order placement that today humans do. And what does that mean for marketers? What does it mean for a media and content creation strategy, publication strategy, is a different discussion. So we'll come to that bridge when we need to cross it. But I think the human ingenuity will still need to override or sit on top of all the other inputs that AI and ML will provide.
Actually, the only way you can override that and sell to Alexa is going to be a human way, right? I don't think a bot will come up with a way, or I don't think a machine will come up with a way to beat the machine. I think it'll be a human will figure a way to beat the machine.
No, and again, as I said, for another discussion, but I think today, pretty much the way you do optimization on search engine, to have some websites and some brands thrown up higher than other brands and other websites, you'll have to carry out similar kind of optimizations for these kind of machine engines as well. And you have to figure out that in your back of your entire communication platform, what kind of words, what kind of, the metric is going to make Alexa move more towards you versus if it was his Alexa and Varun would have responded differently.
I think the buzzer is talking about an insight that the time is up. So let me take this insight and put down questions back to the audience. So any questions from the audience for this insightful panelist that we have on the board?
Any questions, anyone? Okay, we have a question there. Can we pass on the mic, please? Cordless.
Hi, my name is Gaurav. So my question is, I think when Bharat was sharing that, predictive analysis and AI is so important in today's marketing industry. So I want to know that where has India now, where is India now standing in terms of actually doing those big data, predictive analysis, statistical modeling? Because right now what we're doing is that, we churn data, do data analysis like on a very basic Excel, maybe use 2-3 platforms, but actual predictive analysis based on statistical modeling, linear regression, and with all those multiple variables put together, are we actually doing that, or we are just saying okay, ek variable ke saath ek variable compare kiya and that's it? Because I don't think that kind of platform is actually in place.
I could take that. Yes, India is the hub of a lot of the predictive analytics that happens, not just for India, but for all over the world. India has perhaps the largest population of very sophisticated R programmers, Python programmers, you name it, in terms of machine learning, deep learning. And we're actually we have hubs in India providing services not just to brands in India, but also all over the world. So yes, there is a lot of analytics happening based out of India and being done for the rest of the world. It usually is not a very front-facing function. As I mentioned, analytics is usually a decision support system. So what the outside world sees is only the decision that was influenced. What the outside world sees is not the multivariate regression or the Bayesian models or any of the other sophisticated techniques that went in. But across sectors, yes, India is actually at the forefront of using such techniques.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. A little time crunch here. That would be
thank you. Thanks a lot for sharing these wonderful insights about how we are leveraging data and analytics in the future. I think video is all about the future, the way India is moving. And definitely, we need another round of catch-up to understand the hypothesis what Karan has built so far on the chatbots, AI, and ML. So thank you. Thanks for
thank
being
you.
Here.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable inputs. May I request Subrat to join us here on the stage and help us in acknowledging the set of panelists that we have. I'd like to begin by thanking our moderator, Bharat Khatri. Give it up, everyone, ladies and gentlemen, for Bharat Khatri. Thank you so much, Bharat. We'd also like to thank our panelists, Roopak Saluja, Varun Duggirala. Thank you, Varun. We'd also like to thank Karan Kumar. Thank you, Karan. And of course, Aarti, Bhardwaj. Kindly felicitate our moderator as well. Thank you, Bharat, again. Thank you so much. So with this, I'd like to thank all the panelists, our moderator for the session. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Thank you, ma'am, for such an interesting round of discussion out here. Thank you very much.